This is my first time really doing a video like this, and I'll be honest, I really don't know entirely what I'm doing, so I'm just gonna jump right in. A lot of people like Battlefront 2. It's just one of those games that's gone down in Star Wars history. I mean, I should know, I grew up playing it, I made a Let's Play for Rise of the Empire, and I've created two Iceberg videos based off the game. Why, yes, this is a shameless plug, go watch those. But even in addition to the gameplay, which is already great, it's the campaign that seems to have resonated with a lot of people the most. Following the 501st throughout what was basically the entire Star Wars saga, at least at the time of 2005. But despite all that praise and everyone remembering this game so fondly, I've never seen a video or anything analyzing or providing a retrospective for the campaign. Yes, Battlefront 2 itself has many retrospective videos, all of them good, but I've always wanted to see one for the Rise of the Empire campaign specifically. And, well, I mean, everyone always says that the best YouTube videos you can make are the ones you'd want to watch, so over the next few weeks, I think I want to analyze Battlefront 2 campaign and make a retrospective of sorts. Now, you'll notice I said weeks rather than just one video because I've decided to analyze each level individually rather than going through all of them at once. There's a couple reasons I chose this. The first, which I am not afraid to tell you, is that I need the content. I want to keep posting videos consistently, but due to my work and schedule just getting very busy, I can't devote large amounts of time to videos, and surprisingly, writing these one episode at a time is pretty easy whenever I have a minute, and then I can just record them in my office before I leave work for the day. In addition to that, shorter videos are going to be way more manageable than editing and creating one super long video. And I want to strike while the iron's hot, and I've got some motivation. I am planning to combine them all into a single long video when all the episodes are done, but in the meantime, I'm going through one at a time and just kind of picking up where I left off with each new video. But this introduction has gone on long enough. Why don't we actually take a look at the game itself? Funnily enough, our journey doesn't even begin with the actual campaign, but rather the training mission. This serves as a sort of prologue level to teach you the ropes. There isn't much here, it's a pretty standard introduction, but in addition to introducing the gameplay, I think it also introduces you to the tone and the themes you can expect while playing through the rest of the campaign. It has the exact same structure as any other level. For example, each level begins with a journal entry written by a clone who's a part of the 501st Legion. The tutorial is exactly the same. Give it a listen.
My first day as a member of the 501st. It was hot, it was sandy, chaotic. Nothing at all like the simulations on Kamino. Of course, that's pretty much the way it was for all of us, wasn't it? All that breeding, all those years of training. It doesn't really prepare you for all the screaming or the blood, does it? Frankly, I'm still amazed we ever made it through the first hour. Never mind the first day.
From this journal entry, you know that this is going to be a darker depiction of the Star Wars universe. Now, yes, Star Wars has never shied away from the, no pun intended, dark side of things. The original trilogy has torture, dismemberment, possibly sexual exploitation. And of course, the prequels have Order 66, which is essentially a religious genocide. But the movies never dwelt on these things long. Or they would just be romanticized like any other fantasy action setting. Yes, Star Wars has always had a bit of edge to it, but in a more fantastical way. I mean, it is a movie series meant for children, after all. But this journal entry feels more like something from an interview with a World War II veteran. It establishes the tone as a grittier, grounded, more boots-on-the-ground story, coming from someone who has seen the horrors of war firsthand. Now, I don't think anyone is going to disagree when I say that Tamira Mortensen deserves props for his role as this game's narrator. I can't say for certain that it's his best role ever, simply because, well, I haven't seen everything he's done. But this is certainly his best Star Wars role in my mind. His delivery is natural, organic. It feels like a soldier bitterly remembering some of the most miserable experiences of his career. And props to the writers as well. I mean, yes, Mortensen's delivery is incredible, but it's the writers who actually created the dialogue he speaks. Focusing on the heat and the sand makes this feel more personal before we get into the actual carnage of the battle. Think about what's being said here. Not even a literal lifetime of preparing for war and training for combat got these men ready for what they would face. It gets you into a particular mindset as you load into a match and are allowed to choose your first unit. Now, there's not too much to say in the gameplay department for the moment, but I think it might be good to take a break from the thematic for a minute. Again, it's a tutorial. You cycle through the different classes, you learn the different playstyles you'll be using. To start off with, you're the only soldier on the field. As you're establishing a forward command post, there's nothing, no one, except for you and the environment. It would be peaceful if you weren't haunted by the cutscene you had just watched, and the knowledge of knowing what's coming next. And then all of a sudden, you're in the middle of a war, firing away into oncoming legions, establishing a resupply depot, a medical droid, utilizing massive instruments of war like an ATTE, blasting away spider droids and anything else that might stand in your way. You feel like you're in the battles. And that's what everyone always says is this game's strong suit. You feel like you're in the middle of a Star Wars battle. But I think part of why it stands out so much is because of its framing through the eyes of someone who was there. Now, while I was playing through this level a second time to get some more footage, something really neat happened. For a moment, it was only me versus a slowly growing army of battle droids. Then all of a sudden, I turned around and just saw waves of clones rush into the fray. Of course, I know in my head that there's no more than maybe 16 or so clones present, but for a second, I bought into the lie again. It felt like an army I was witnessing. Seeing those clones rush in the battle gave me that feeling I first felt whenever I played this game oh so long ago. Even after 18 years, it still provides such a magical and nostalgic experience as a Star Wars fan. Now, there's still many more things that I want to mention, but I think I will save them as talking points for later missions. What I do want to touch on is a very notable occurrence which sets up another theme for the first half of the campaign. To properly set this up, though, I want you to stop and think for a second. Who is the protagonist of this game? Is it the narrator? Well, we know it can't be him because it's just one guy and we play as multiple distinct clones in this mission. We'll circle back to some talking points about this later, but for now, the protagonist seems to be the 501st itself. In the campaign of most multiplayer shooters, you fill the role of some commando or special unit or named character who cannot die. When you get shot, you respawn at the previous checkpoint like nothing happened. But in Battlefront, when you die, fighting goes on, and you move into the role of a different soldier. There is no action movie protagonist, there is no chosen one, there is only the clone army. Not a single clone, but rather every clone all at once. We play as the clones, we die as the clones. It's a clone narrating from his journal, which makes it so weird when a Jedi shows up. The last gameplay mechanic that you are taught is the hero class. Heroes are, well, heroes and characters from the movies who work as a more powerful bonus unit. They outshine the standard units, and soon, you forget about that sniper or engineer you were playing as a minute ago while you're mowing down battle droids with a lightsaber. But as we just established, this is a clone story. So why is it that Mace Windu gets remembered when the Battlefront is littered with clones who fought and died before he even arrived. Oh yes, I might be embellishing a bit, but I do think that there is a resentment that builds up towards the Jedi in the hearts of these clones across the first few missions of the campaign. And here, it's demonstrated through gameplay. Everyone remembers the Jedi. Everyone wants to play as the Jedi, the leader. Not the men who died in service to them, who failed to get recognition. Now, the mission closes with a more hopeful journal entry.
Incredibly, the 501st survived the crucible of Geonosis, emerging battle-hardened and ready for whatever the war would throw at us.
For just a moment, all is well. Victory is achieved, and while there are still many battles left to come, we're left with a hope. A hope that we, the good guys, will prevail. Because we are the good guys. We are the hero in this story. Right?